Welcome back. For many of us, Queen Victoria brings to mind images of a monarch permanently in mourning, it seems, a rather severe-looking woman, always dressed in black and spending years grieving for the husband with whom she had 9 children.
But a new film called The Young Victoria sheds light on her early life, showing her romantic side and her extraordinary love affair with Prince Albert. Well, Emily Blunt takes on the title role. She joins us now along with the movie's producer, Graham King. Good morning to you both. Before we speak to them, let's have a quick look at the film.
Do you ever feel like a chess piece yourself? In a game being played against your will?
Do you?
Constantly. I see them leaning in and moving me around the board.
The Duchess and Sir John.
Not just them. Uncle Leopold. The King. Sure, half the politicians are ready to seize hold of my skirts and drag me from square to square.
Then you had better master the rules of the game until you play it better than they can.
You don't recommend I find a husband to play it for me?
I should find one to play it with you, not for you.
Oh, romantic.
Okay. And that was it, she's sold.
Yeah. But that chess scene actually was part of the process of finding the right Albert, wasn't it?
Yes, I think they did a big search for him.
We did.
And then I read with about 5 of them, and I don't know how to play chess, but Rupert taught me a bit on the day, and then because he was the last one to come in, and he was the only one who actually knew how to play chess, and he was the only one for the part.
So that was the test to see if there was the chemistry across the board.
Yeah.
That would work with you.
Yeah, I think so, because it's so vital, because you really had to believe that these two were very much in love, and also that you needed an actor with that kind of gravitas to be able to compete with her, because she was so strong as a person, and you had to believe that Albert absolutely took the reins and reeled in all of that emotion and reckless decision making and ruled alongside her.
How keen were you to do this role?
I was beyond keen. I literally begged for it.
I got a call in my office from Emily's agent that said that Emily Blunt wanted to come in and see you. And I'd just seen Devil Wears Prada, and I thought she may want a job as an assistant or something like that. And she came in and she said, I want to play young Queen Victoria, and I'm not leaving this office till you say yes. And that's really how it started.
So no choice. I mean, you obviously had people you wanted to use, right. But since she wasn't going to go.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was one of those movies that came together really quick. Most of the movies that I've been involved with take a lot of years to develop and cast and put on a director.
I mean, there's any number of projects you would look at, but why particularly did you want this one?
It's just one of those rare roles. They're just not out there, you know. And I mean, I think I loved this new revelation of Victoria that people hadn't seen, and she was so complicated, as human beings are. You know, it was just beautifully written. I thought it was an unusual script for a period drama, because you saw the performance side of being the Queen of England, and then you saw her very private life behind closed doors, and I loved that dual existence that you saw, which you hadn't really seen before.
And you mentioned, Graham, how it all began, really. It was from a synopsis, intriguingly enough, and interestingly enough, from Sarah Ferguson, Duchess of York.
Right, exactly. I had a meeting with her, and she gave me about 6 or 7 projects that she was working on or developing or wanted to talk about. And out of it was this 2-page synopsis on the story of young Queen Victoria, her love story. And I've been wanting to make a film in the UK for a long time. And I got very intrigued by that. And I was shooting this film, Departed, at the time, and I go back and I talk to Martin Scorsese about it, and he's such a historian, he knew that it had never been done. And we decided...
And there's so much more to the story than certainly I'd imagine. I thought, oh yeah, right, Victoria comes to the throne, falls in love with Prince Albert, yada, yada, yada. Mm-hmm. But in fact, she had a really difficult childhood.
Very. Right. And I think that was surprising to me, that she'd actually had the kind of staying power and resilience to push through that lonely existence where she wasn't allowed friends, she wasn't allowed to read books, she had to sleep in the same room as her mother till she was 18. I mean, and she had the absolute knowledge that she would be great throughout all of this. I think she found out she was going to be queen when she was 11,
right.
And cried all night, and then said to her nurse that night, she just said, I will be good, at the age of 11. And so she was she had incredible strength of character to overcome that lonely existence, and become queen in the way that she did.
And you said, Jimmy, you absolutely loved this character, yeah. and her as a person. You went off and read, in depth, I think, about
yes.
it, didn't you?
Said yes, you. I mean, the biographies are very helpful, and the most helpful thing to me was to read her diaries, because she kept a very consistent sort of revealing diary, actually. She spoke very openly about a lot of things, and I felt like I could actually hear her voice. She spoke very emphatically and passionately about things, and I could hear the essence of her sort of coming through.
And interesting sort of funny moment where, because of the protocol of royalty, when it came to the big moment, of course, Albert couldn't ask her.
Mm-hmm.
It had to be the other way around. We've got to look at that.
Okay.
I do want you to feel quite at home. I'm sure you're aware why I wished you to come here. Because it would make me happier than anything. Too happy, really, if you would agree to what I wish.
And stay with you.
And stay with me.
And marry you.
And marry me.
Potent. I like it a lot. It's been wonderful to watch. And in terms of, Emily said she wasn't going away, but what were your first impressions of her when she did actually begin to play Victoria?
Yes, what were they?
I thought she was perfect, obviously. Yeah,
but
I mean, she really did a lot of homework, which is always wonderful as a producer when you see actors really get into the character and know the roles that they're playing. And she was just really natural. She was born to play this role.
And when you watch the film, you understand, I suppose, in a sense, why it was that his death eventually affected her so deeply, because it was a really remarkable love story. And he had to work very hard, actually,
yes.
to get in there.
Yes, he did. I mean, I think I could understand, after reading about the love she had for him, why she mourned him obsessively for the rest of her life. I mean, she was passionate. She loved very intensely. She hated very intensely. And so, I mean, even when I was reading about it, when they had all of their children and he was alive and he would go away for the weekend, and it was like a cloud descended on the castle and everything ceased to exist unless he was around. I mean,
and not always by any means a popular queen.
No, you know, no, she made some reckless decisions, and you see that in the film, particularly those kind of teenage reckless decisions she made.
Mm. So young.
Mm. In terms of filming, you say it was an easy film to make. We had an awful lot of locations to cover. 17, I think it was.
Right. Well, the easy part was putting the film together, and we had to shoot it, which was a lot more complicated. But we were given great locations. I mean, we were absolutely kind of everyone welcomed us.
Arundel Castle, Lincoln Cathedral, Blenheim Palace, Hampton Court Palace.
Right, mm-hmm. Great places.
Authenticity. Yeah. We had to have authentic. Yeah.
And in terms of plans for you, Graham, you've got the remake of Edge of Darkness coming out.
Right, at the end of the year, yes. We just finished shooting in Boston with Mel Gibson. His comeback movie.
Have you Americanized it?
A little bit, yes. Yes,
and
we have.
Mel Gibson's comeback movie?
Mel Gibson's comeback movie. It's very, very excited about it.
Yeah, fabulous.
Very popular.
Emily, what next for you?
Well, I did The Wolfman, which is going to be coming out in the autumn with Benicio del Toro and Anthony Hopkins, and I think the title pretty much says it all. But
The Wolfman.
The Wolfman.
Which particular Wolfman are we talking about?
Did you say the DJ?
Oh,
you're
DJ
much cooler
DJ.
Than I am. I don't know.
I know. He's actually DJ Wolfman. I remember The Wolfman.
Yeah,
DJ Wolfman.
Absolutely.
Who?
Benicio plays a wolf man.
Oh, right.
So it's set in late Victorian. Okay. Yeah, a real wolf man.
Any one of a number of things.
It could have been anything. Right. Yeah.
I'll explain
it's
to you
horror.
About the other wolf man.
Please do. Enlighten me. I don't know anything about DJ Wolfman.
We'll tell you after. Lovely to see you both.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. And you can see The Young Victoria in cinemas from this Friday.
Carol.